I have time for just one last question, and it takes a little bit away from COVID. I wanted to ask you about the tragic incident we saw on the football field on Monday when Damar Hamlin crashed the ground with an apparent cardiac arrest. What is the biggest takeaway for you as an emergency physician from what we saw there on the field?
Well, we still don't know what is the what is going to happen with Mr. Hamlin, and so I think my prayers and my thoughts are certainly with him and his family at the moment. You know, I was doing response on CNN immediately following the really shocking scenes of cardiac arrest and paramedics and the medical team doing chest compressions and using defibrillator, et cetera, on the football field. And there was a lot of talk about how this once again illustrates how dangerous football is. I don't think that that's the right takeaway. I mean, football is a very dangerous sport. I've actually been writing a series for the Post, too, on how to make football safer and the issues with repeat concussions and the dangers, for example, of chronic traumatic encephalopathy associated with even the subconcussive hits to the head. So football is clearly very dangerous. But in this case, it seems that the most likely diagnosis for what happened is a direct impact to the chest causing cardiac arrest, which is a very rare but very serious condition called commotio cordis. That condition actually is most frequently seen in younger athletes between the ages of 14 and 15. And so what I was thinking was, look, this happened at this NFL game with more than 20 trained medical staff available who were able to come and immediately work on resuscitating Mr. Hamlin. But what if this happened at a youth lacrosse game or a high school softball game or a junior high karate gym or something else? We need to make sure that we also have people trained in CPR. We need to make sure that we have AEDs available in those settings. And so I hope that people will take away the need for us to really look at youth sports and to make sure that we have, we are all trained as parents, as coaches, as teachers on CPR, and that we know where an AED is available in settings all around us.
A new study out of the New England Journal of Medicine has released an alarming study. It found that Black and Hispanic individuals are less likely to receive CPR from bystanders than white individuals.
The Cows, Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of racism. Today's date, Monday. Excuse me, we had the holiday, Dr. King. Tuesday, January 17, 2023. So I have been told, Damar Hamlin, I am very thankful that he survived and that he seems to be recuperating and doing well and all the rest of it. But wow, that is the whole impetus for the program that we are doing this here evening, Tuesday. And specifically, just a few short days ago, Damar Hamlin, 24-year-old Black male, handsome as can be, whole life ahead of him, should be, when he could have died on the field, I went on social media while he was still down and CPR was being administered the first time. They said two times they had to resuscitate him, unfortunately. I tweeted out the very report that we are talking about, racial and ethnic differences in bystander CPR for witnessed cardiac arrest, because we had just talked about that. And I said, man, Damar Hamlin is lucky. If he had not been on that football field, brain damage and all, Black males, Black people, as you heard, Hispanic, less likely to get CPR in any environment. I tweeted that out immediately. There were lots of folks. I got all kinds of folks who were nasty and ugly and everything. Hey, man, the study is racial and ethnic differences in bystander CPR for witnessed cardiac arrest. And it's not even that old. This was published just at the end of last year. We talked about this in so much detail. It had such an impact on listeners. Listeners talked about, hey, I remember going to school with predominantly non-white people. We didn't have CPR class. We moved, went to a predominantly white school. We had CPR training. We had Irie in Louisiana, who was so impacted as a teacher, she got a CPR class, got it to be taught for her area. Black people can be get the information so that they will be informed, certified. That can help with a job too. But hey, that is saving lives, all impacted by the very report we are going to discuss in detail this evening. Man, I am so excited. Our guest is one of the co-authors, and he actually, just because I did my research, I didn't just read the report. Hey, let's check the references, check the footnotes. Wow, he has been discussing, researching this important issue for well over a decade. Wow. We are so impressed, thankful to have as our guest for the evening, co-author of this amazing report, Dr. Paul S. Chan. Dr. Chan, you with us, sir?
I am, Gus. Thank you so much for having me on your show tonight.
Wow. We are super grateful that you could share some of your valuable time with us. We do not have you for the full program, so we will maximize the time that we have you. For our listeners who maybe haven't heard us talking about this really important document before, can you just give us briefly kind of a little bit of background info, who you are, the work that you do?
Sure. So I am a cardiologist, so a heart doctor. And I spend about two-thirds of my time doing research, and a lot of it is on cardiac arrest, what we're talking about today. And the remaining third of the time, I see patients, and I'm based in Kansas City at the St. Luke's Mid-America Heart Institute. And as you mentioned, the other speaker that will be joining us tonight is Dr. Anezi Uzendu in about 45 minutes. And he is a fascinating young man. He is finished with his cardiology training as well. And he can also provide you some of the experiences of being a Black man who himself had a cardiac arrest and was shocked, like Damar Hamlin, when he was playing basketball, and had the same type of, not same type of injury, but the same type of arrest rhythm. And he can share with you his journey and his experience as not only a cardiac arrest survivor, but also as a researcher. As you mentioned, cardiac arrest is now in the forefront of conversation, especially amongst those of us who enjoy watching football and also have kids who play sports and have been brought to this consciousness about how prevalent this condition is. It turns out that in the United States, every year, every day, there are about 1,000 cardiac arrests that occur outside the hospital, like the one that Damar Hamlin has. A cardiac arrest is when the heart stops and the person is no longer breathing on their own and no longer has heart movement. And without any intervention, the person will die. And the person has died, in essence. And the most important thing that we can do as citizens in this country is when we see somebody collapse, is to determine if they are in cardiac arrest, to start CPR until the paramedics, the fire and police, first responders arrive and can deliver additional care. And that was the basis of what we were interested in looking at in this paper in the New England Journal of Medicine, which is, when an individual has a cardiac arrest, are you less likely to get potentially life-saving CPR from a bystander? It could be a family member, a friend, or a stranger, if you're Black or Hispanic, as compared to someone who's of white race.
Fascinating on so many accounts. Wowee. Maximizing our time here. One, you already answered one of my questions. So you are actually a medical doctor?
I am. I was trained as both an adult and a pediatric doctor, and I've gotten additional training in cardiology, and so I work as a cardiologist at this point.
Wow. Fascinating. So smart. For folks who have not seen you or read more of your work on this subject matter, more than a decade of research, you are a non-white male, is that correct?
Correct. I am of Chinese background. I was an immigrant to the United States, born in Hong Kong, came to the United States at age 7. And I've lived in very different areas around the world and in this country. I spent time mostly in the Northeast doing my training. I was at Harvard undergraduate and also at Harvard for the medical training. And I was at Johns Hopkins for medical school. But I spent years of my life living a year in the mountains in rural Appalachia in eastern Kentucky, where I saw poverty amongst white individuals like I'd never seen before. I spent a year also as a volunteer working as a lobbyist on hunger issues in Washington, D.C. And then I spent 4 years working and living in the middle of nowhere in northeastern Arizona on the Navajo Nation, working amongst indigenous peoples and on healthcare issues there. And I spent time working and living in villages overseas in Latin America and in the Middle East.
Wow, that is amazing. You must have the greatest photo album in the history of the world. Wow.
A lot of things of different gifts, yes, indeed.
Wow. We are in awe, Dr. Chan. Okie dokie. Get it together to discuss your really important research. Just given what you've said, we had a whole health pandemic that's lasted 3+ years now that our former president did blame on people like you to some degree. Has the whole COVID-19 and racism, white supremacy with regards to Asian people specifically, has that been an issue for you at any point in the last 3 years?
Myself personally, I have not encountered racist incidents, but I certainly know individuals who are of Asian descent or background, either born natively and raised in the United States or immigrants who are afraid to go out. My parents live in Sacramento, and they don't go out anymore. They're older, but there have been incidents in the California area, in Northern California, that have given them pause. So, indeed, when I grew up in New York City, it was in the slums in the Lower East Side, and it was not uncommon for me to be called racial epithets, whether it was chink or something else. So certainly I experienced that as a young child, but not as an adult.
Wow. Wow. We're 3 years in, and you said your parents in Sacramento, they're still concerned about going out? They're afraid to go out still?
There remains occasional incidents, even in Northern California, which we consider rather liberal. And so, yes, they are still pretty hesitant. The only times they go out is to shop. And so it's been said for me to watch them be more reclusive as a result, because in many ways their ability to be free to go about their lives outside of their home has been severely curtailed.
Dang. Sorry to hear that, sir. System of racism. We ask all of our guests, at least in my view, when we get to the crux of kind of everything in terms of why our former president would be blaming non-white people and saying it's the Chinese virus and all the rest of that, and the result of that having his parents and many, many, many other non-white people where they are literally afraid of going outside, fear of being terrorized. Vincent Cho, we played that clip that was in California where he said, go the F back to Vietnam, and the whole crowd cheered. I've concluded all of that. You talked about working on the reservations before. I've concluded that all of that is the product of the system of racism, white supremacy, and even the results of your study. I use the term racism and the term white supremacy as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
There is certainly a propensity for people, not only in the United States, but in other countries as well, to objectify and to subjugate people that are different from themselves. If you look at Central and South America, it is often the case that the individuals who are holding power are of lighter skin or of Spanish descent as compared to Afro-Caribbean backgrounds and descents. I spent a lot of time working and living in Guatemala. It's probably been there about 20 times in my life. And there was a systematic genocide of the Mayan people between 1980 to 1995. It probably estimated Amnesty International about 300,000, 400,000 Mayan indigenous people, 10% of the population back then, had been exterminated by a largely Ladino background Guatemalan population who held the reins of power. So I think that there has historically been that tendency, certainly in the Western Hemisphere, and you see that probably in many areas outside of North America as well. So that tendency has been the case, and it seems to at least be defined oftentimes by both, as you described, racism by the color of one's skin or the definition of who is of what race, but also by gender.
We have limited time for listeners. That's the sort of thing, because you said mistreatment on the basis of people being different and even gender. That is not what I said in my definition, and that is very important. That's the sort of thing where I tell our guests generally, just if my definition is not accurate, no is great. That just, I know where we are, but this is one I'm very specific for a reason. Everything that you said, I'm saying that the result or the product of that, or the result or all of that, is the result of the system of white supremacy racism. So I'm going to give the definition one more time, and just, if you don't think that's accurate, that is great. You can just say no. But my definition, a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think that's accurate? Does such a system exist, Dr. Chan?
I mean, I would say that generally that is accurate. Sometimes it's semantics, but I think that racism can be conscious and also be also unconscious for individuals or for institutions. So it may not even be oftentimes, and so part of it is maybe the words we use and how we define those words, as you mentioned. But I also think that racism can be both structural and sometimes unconscious on an individual or even institutional level. Oftentimes it's both conscious and unconscious, but I suppose we have somewhat nuanced understandings of racism.
Oh, for sure. That's why I always like to make that clear from the beginning, so I know what the other person's thought process, their definition about racism is. Let's see. How did you, because you've been studying this for over a decade, when I say this in terms of bystander CPR responses for white people, non-white people, how did you get started in this field of study?
So one of the things we want to understand is why Black and Hispanic people, when they have a cardiac arrest, are less likely to survive, period. Damar Hamlin is the outlier. When an individual in the United States has a cardiac arrest, outside the hospital, their chance of surviving and leaving the hospital alive right now is 8 to 10% for all comers with a cardiac arrest. That includes people who have them at airports, people who have them at gyms, people who collapse in the streets, people who collapse at home, 8 to 10%. The type of rhythm, there's four rhythms for a cardiac arrest, and two of them are treatable by a defibrillator, and two of them are not. The one that Damar Hamlin had was treatable by a defibrillator. When a person has that type of arrest in public right now in the United States, the likelihood of surviving is 30 to 40%. So one in three chance. And Damar Hamlin is very lucky because not only did he survive his cardiac arrest, his brain is intact. And as far as anyone can tell right now, he did not lose a lot of brain or organ function as a result of that cardiac arrest. It turns out for the vast majority of both white and non-white individuals with a cardiac arrest, most people die. And those who live, about 20% have significant neurological disability or injury that will last for at least months, if not for the rest of their life. So what we know in the U.S. is even with the low rates of surviving a cardiac arrest, if you're white, you're more likely to survive than if you're Black or Hispanic. And so what we were interested in understanding is, are there intermediary processes that make it less likely for a Black or Hispanic person to survive when they have a cardiac arrest than a white individual? And we know that perhaps the two most influential things that affects your ability to survive a cardiac arrest are, number one, did somebody start CPR as fast and as soon as possible after you collapsed from a cardiac arrest? And number two, how quickly did somebody bring a defibrillator to your bedside or to wherever you are to see if they could shock you out of that rhythm? And that person could be the bystander. It could be a first responder, policeman or fireman or woman, or it could be the paramedics from an ambulance. Those are the two things that will determine more than anything else whether you live or die. And the one thing we know is that when we collapse, oftentimes, there may be other people around. And so what we were interested in this study in understanding is whether you get potentially life-saving CPR, which increases your odds of surviving by 2 to 4-fold. That's huge. If your survival likelihood is about 10%, and if you can double that likelihood, if somebody starts CPR within the first minute or two, that is huge. You could save somebody's life. And so we had done prior research about 7 years ago, looking already at where CPR training is done in the United States. The two major organizations that do CPR training currently are the American Heart Association and the American Red Cross, although other groups do CPR training. And it turns out that most of the training that is currently done still today is being done in predominantly white communities and less frequently in Black and Hispanic and other non-white communities. And as a result, it is no surprise that when somebody has a cardiac arrest, that if you're Black or Hispanic, you're less likely to get potentially life-saving CPR because you may not have been your family members and your community members may not have been trained in delivering CPR because of our prior work. In this study that we published and that you referenced, what we were particularly interested in was whether that lower likelihood of getting CPR if you're Black or Hispanic and you collapse from a cardiac arrest is whether or not you're less likely not only to get bystander CPR at home, which we expected would be the case because we already knew that training rates are lower in Black and Hispanic communities. So no surprise, since most of the cardiac arrests occur at home, we expected Black and Hispanic individuals to be less likely to get CPR at home. But also, whether they were also less likely to get CPR when the cardiac arrest occurred in public, on the streets, at the gym, at the airport, where we would expect a larger number of people who would walk by or pass by who could potentially intervene, and they could be of different races and ethnicities and have different backgrounds and training, and increase the likelihood that you'll get potentially life-saving CPR. And we had hypothesized at the outset, before we did any analyses, that there would be some disparity for CPR provision for Black and Hispanic individuals when the cardiac arrest occurred at home, but that gap would narrow when it occurred in public. And in fact, we found quite the opposite, which shocked us. If your cardiac arrest occurred in public, in the streets, at the gym, at work, at the airport, the likelihood, the disparity increased. And if you're Black or Hispanic, you were even less likelier to get potential life-saving CPR when you're arrested in public as compared with at home, which really raised a number of difficult and important questions as to why that was the case.
Very deflating, all of that. Much of that, but wow, so brilliant analysis. I'm just reading a little bit from your brilliant and deflating work. This is on page 6. Black and Hispanic persons had lower incidence of survival to discharge and favorable neurologic discharge than white persons, both for cardiac arrests at home and in public locations. Differences according to race and ethnic group in survival outcomes were attenuated with further adjustment for receipt of bystander CPR and initial cardiac arrest rhythm. Finally, we examined the incidence of bystander CPR according to public location type. Black and Hispanic persons were less likely than white persons to receive bystander CPR in every public location category. And it's broken down by category. I'm laughing to keep from crying. Black and Hispanic persons typically have worse survival after out-of-hospital cardiac arrest than white persons, but the reasons for this finding are not clear. Using a national U.S. registry, we found large racial and ethnic differences in the incidence of bystander CPR for witnessed out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. The relative likelihood of receiving bystander CPR at home was 26% lower for Black and Hispanic persons than for white persons, and the likelihood of bystander CPR for arrests in public locations was 37% lower for Black and Hispanic persons than for white persons. These differences were present across neighborhoods, accounting for differences in the incidence of bystander CPR attenuated the racial and ethnic differences in cardiac arrest survival. When I went through and looked at this, even in fact, before I get to my question, I just want to back up for folks who don't have medical background, myself included. The first portion that I read where you talked about the Black and Hispanic persons lower incidence of survival to discharge and favorable neurologic discharge than white persons. Can you explain what that means so that like a high schooler would understand and how getting CPR would mitigate those results?
Yeah, no, excellent points. So survival to discharge is, can you leave the hospital alive after a cardiac arrest? And it turns out that if you're Black or Hispanic and have a cardiac arrest, you're less likely to get a pulse back, to make it to the hospital, and certainly to make it alive and survive the hospital stay. Favorable neurological discharge is basically a fancy term that we use to say individuals who survive and do not have severe neurological deficits, meaning that, so what a severe neurological deficit is, you can't feed yourself. You can't walk on your own. You have lost language. You've lost brain function to the point where you need assistance with every activity that you do, including bathing, dressing, eating. And if you're Black or Hispanic, not only are you less likely, if you have a cardiac arrest as compared to a white person, to leave the hospital alive, you're also less likely to leave the hospital without severe neurological disability, meaning that you're not going to do as well neurologically. So that's huge. And the way CPR works by compressing on the chest is it artificially, for the time that you're doing CPR, you're actually moving blood from the heart and distributing the blood to your vital organs, to your brain, to your liver, every other organ in the body, including your heart itself. Because the heart is stopped, after the first 3 minutes, maybe 4 at the best, you start losing brain cells. You start losing other organ cells. So that's why it is so critical. Once you start losing brain cells, that process can be irreversible if no one starts CPR and you do not get a pulse back within the first 5 to 6 minutes. And that delay is huge, and not getting anybody to start CPR is the difference oftentimes as to why somebody lives or dies. I mentioned that 10% of the people make it alive out of the hospital, but 35% make it alive with a pulse to the hospital. The reason why that drops off from 35% to 10% is not because of the heart. It's because of brain death. And so when we do CPR and you are compressing the chest, you are actually moving blood and delivering oxygen to your important organs and keeping them alive as much as possible. And it is so critical that somebody starts that as soon as possible to limit the likelihood that there's any brain or other organ damage. CPR training doesn't require extensive time, although the CPR training courses do take 3 to 4 hours, and oftentimes is a barrier for many people to get CPR training because there's a cost associated with it, anywhere from $100 to $200 from the American Heart Association. The YMCA locally in Kansas City does them for $50 to $60, but that's still a charge. And that's oftentimes one other reason besides why, besides the fact that CPR training is done less frequently in Black and Hispanic communities, why Black and Hispanic families are less likely to be trained in CPR and delivering it to the loved one when needed. And in many ways, that's a form of, if you will, structural racism, that the structures have been designed to favor one race versus another, maybe not consciously, but at the same time, it's created a system of haves and have-nots in training. In our study, though, Gus, what was really also difficult to tease out and understand why is that even in Black and Hispanic communities, if you're Black or Hispanic and collapse from a cardiac arrest, you were less likely to get CPR than if you were white in the same community. So we found this to be the case not only in mostly predominantly white communities where 80% of the residents were white, but we found this to be consistent in communities of color. And there are different reasons we hypothesize as to why this is occurring. We think that when it occurs in a white community and a Black or Hispanic person is less likely to get CPR when they have a cardiac arrest than a white person, there's probably explicit racism that comes into play and maybe some implicit racism as to why people don't respond. When it occurs in a Black and Hispanic community where more than 50% of the residents are Black or Hispanic and you're still less likely to get bystander CPR if you're Black or Hispanic compared to a white individual, we think that there probably is more implicit racism that is at play as to the assumptions we bring to the table when a Black or Hispanic person collapses in our neighborhood as compared to a white person. So it's very complex, and it's very it's not a one-size-fits-all type of racism, if you will.
That was painful as well. When I read the study, I went to footnote 31 for what Dr. Chan just shared with us in terms, even in a so-called Black neighborhood, non-white neighborhood, white people are still more likely to get CPR than the Black and Hispanic people, as they are called. I went to footnote 31, not only whites, racial priming effect for Black faces in Black people. You think that that report helps us maybe understand a little bit of what's happening, why Black people don't get CPR even in so-called Black neighborhoods?
It's all speculation because we don't have the data on the bystanders themselves. I do a lot of volunteer work, and I spend a lot of my free time in East Kansas City, which is largely Black and Hispanic, and working on housing and food security issues. And what I would say is that because in those communities there may be higher incidence of different types of crime or potentially gun violence, there may be some more hesitancy when a Black or Hispanic brother or sister drops dead, literally, than if a white individual that you have no assumptions on, perhaps, drops dead. And I think that we need to be honest with the data that this is not just in one type of community. It's in all types of communities. What I would say, though, however, is that there are great opportunities to broaden our CPR training. And I want to make sure that as I finish up here before Dr. Uzendu joins, that we think about how to be constructive about dealing with the issue of CPR training and cardiac arrest and the differences in rates of getting CPR if you're Black or Hispanic. I think that all of us who have connections or who live in Black and Hispanic communities, who participate in churches that are Black or Hispanic, really need to start thinking about what can I do? How can I make a difference? Damar Hamlin was one faith of a cardiac arrest victim. He happens to be Black. He also happened to arrest on a national stage with many healthcare personnel available who did not hesitate to respond. Most cardiac arrests in the United States currently are going to happen in your home. It's going to be your friend, your parent, your spouse, your child. And it is really incumbent upon all of us to ensure that everybody that we care about is trained. And there are simple courses that don't require the $50 to $200 fees that you can get either online or through the American Heart Association to watch these videos and learn what the process is. We do not recommend any more mouth-to-mouth breathing in CPR. It is all chest compressions. How do you know if somebody's in cardiac arrest? It's very easy to figure out, and these videos will give you those pointers. And then where do you put your chest, and how far do you push down? And do you push down at the tune of staying alive at that beat, 100 to 120 times a minute? Make sure if somebody calls 911 to get the ambulance going, and you continue CPR and trade off with other people who can help until the ambulance or the first responders arrive. We need to make an effort to talk to our pastors, our community centers, to do CPR training, to find ways to bring CPR training at no cost or low cost on a sliding scale to other members of the community. The NFL actually has a golden opportunity. I don't think they'll take it up, but what if, imagine if every playoff game right now, during halftime, they taught CPR for 3 minutes over the next 3 weeks and during the Super Bowl. It would reach half the U.S. population instantaneously across all races, across all socioeconomic backgrounds, And in the context and the background of Damar Hamlin's events, it's a golden opportunity where people are primed to learn and to have training. But I can't speak for the NFL, but this is what otherwise we should be doing so that we can level the playing field, ensure equity in response, and ensure that we take care of ourselves and our loved ones at minimum. You know, you mentioned at the beginning that there was an individual who moved schools from a mostly Black Hispanic school to a white school, and then all of a sudden got CPR training. That's probably not an uncommon occurrence because of funding and mandates at different schools and types of schools around the country. But even then, it's not enough to do that in schools. But I implore all of us to do that because it's going to happen to somebody we care about. And it's going to happen at a time when you're least prepared. And if you have the training, you can respond and potentially provide life-saving interventions for your loved one or even a stranger.
Wow. That is a brilliant idea. Have the NFL, they could do it at the Super Bowl for halftime. Take 5 minutes CPR training. You would reach millions of people all over the world. People watch the Super Bowl and, oh, yeah, that's right. We were just Damar. Yeah, that would be good to know. Okay.
CPR. The spokesperson for the CPR training. I mean, think about how valuable and what a great representative that would be for promulgating the importance of CPR.
Brilliant. Someone should social tweet that to him, what have you, see if they can get Damar Hamlin at halftime, and we're going to do CPR.
But I think that this is going to be a lost opportunity unless we exert enough social media pressure or interest. I know the NFL charges, what is it, $5 million for 30 seconds. It's all about money sometimes, but this has to go beyond dollars and cents.
I don't know. That's sacrilege for a Sunday. Did you have time to get one question before you depart, Dr. Chan?
Sure.
Let's see. Our caller at 2262, did you have a question for Dr. Paul S. Chan, medical doctor?
Hello. Thank you, Gus, for taking my call. May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Chan, for spending some time with us. You said earlier that, unconscious acts of, I guess, racism. I hear this term a lot. Why is it necessary to stress the fact that acts of racism could be unconscious? What is that for?
Yeah, so the terms that typically are used are explicit and implicit or unconscious racism. So just to put sort of center us on what the distinction is, when we normally talk about white supremacy and racist, we're really talking about explicit racism where people are mouthing off racist epithets or verbally or in writing or in action or demonstrating racist tendencies. What I mean by unconscious racism, the two examples of what I discuss are unconscious racism is the following. Number one, one is institutional. The training that is done for CPR has been mostly in white and Hispanic, in white communities and not in Black and Hispanic communities. I don't think the organizations are intentionally racist and saying, I'm not going to do training in Black and Hispanic communities. I'm only going to do it in white communities. But what they've done is done their training in those communities because the classrooms are maybe more available in white communities because there's more facilities in those communities. And that in itself may be a reflection of racism itself. But they're not intentionally trying to deny Black and Hispanic communities of CPR training, but because they've set up the training in places that are less accessible to Black and Hispanic communities, and also because there's a charge for their training, and Black and Hispanic people in general have less disposable income than white in a family, that sets up a dynamic that white individuals from white communities are more likely to be attending the CPR trainings than Black and Hispanic individuals from whichever communities they come from. So that's an example of what I would describe as unconscious or implicit racism at the institutional level. Gus, one of the things that I did when we got the results before we wrote the paper is I went to Google, and you can do this on your own, and you can type in CPR image. I was just curious to see how CPR was portrayed in the general public. And I think it was, I counted, I was like baffled, but like the first 40 or 50 images, if you type in CPR image, maybe it's changed since I've done some radio interviews, but the first 40 to 50 images, both the mannequin for CPR training and the CPR learner were white. There was not one image in the first several dozen that I looked at that showed a Black or Hispanic person of color as the mannequin or the CPR learner. And in doing so, these images again subconsciously suggest to the public that only white individuals should get CPR and only white individuals should learn CPR. I don't think that's the intent, but the convenience of doing whatever images in training leaves out a whole slice of the U.S. population, whether they're Asian, Native American, Hispanic, or Black. And so in some ways, we may internalize those images and say, that's not for me, because I don't see myself in those images, either as the victim or as the responder. And again, that's another form of what I would call unconscious or implicit racism at the institutional level. At the individual level, unconscious racism may emerge in what we found in our study. In a Black or Hispanic community, if you're Black or Hispanic, you're still less likely to get CPR than from a white person. Why is that? Well, I think it's less likely that it's due to explicit racism where a Black or Hispanic person from that community says, I'm not going to respond to a Black or Hispanic person because they don't deserve CPR as much as a white person. But there may be assumptions, whether about safety or about something else, subconsciously or unconsciously, that give an individual pause to respond to a Black or Hispanic person, even from a Black Hispanic community, as compared to a white person. And so that's what I'm trying to get at in terms of implicit bias or unconscious racism. It's not what we normally think of as racism, but it does change not only the outcome, but the response of one race versus another.
Much obliged for your question and your thorough response, Dr. Chan. I did look CPR image, and it's pretty much exactly what Dr. Chan said. It did take me a while to kind of flip through here and find a dark person, and then much less a dark person getting CPR from another dark person. Like, yeah, most of the images are pretty pale. Before we let you depart, Dr. Chan, you said you're an Asian male. What are the results, do you know, for individuals classified as Asian? Is there any discrepancy in terms of their response for CPR bystander?
Very good question. It's buried in, I think, appendix table 7 or 8 in the paper. if you're aging and you have a cardiac arrest, you have the same likelihood of getting CPR than a white person.
Hmm. Why do you think that is?
They're whiter in general. I think that's probably it. And I think that although there's a lot of heterogeneity, there's a lot of variability in Asians. There's Far East Asians who are light-skinned in general, and there's Southeast Asians that are darker. But Asians as a group, as compared to white individuals from the same community, the same census tract, we're mapping people out as to where they have their cardiac arrest. They get the same likelihood, almost to the exact tenth of the percentage point, as a white person.
Hmm. Wow. Now that is thorough.
It has a lot to do with skin color in this case more than anything else, and racism, if you will. We were struck by that. We thought maybe it would be somewhere in between, but no, it was almost identical. Almost the same identical rate as whites.
Hmm. Wow. Well, I learned quite a bit, and look at that, right on time. Dr. Uzindu is waiting in the wings for us. I labeled the broadcast for today. Damar Hamlin was lucky. I did that just, I guess, being ignorant or whatever the case is. Dr. Chan came and said the exact same thing that I called the program, but he gave the detail as to, oh yes, he was lucky. Exactly how lucky? I think he said 8 to 10% of the people who have that sort of cardiac event, about 8 to 10% of the people live. Yes, that would be super lucky. Buy a lottery ticket, buy 5 of them, Mr. Hamlin. My goodness. Wow, I learned a ton, Dr. Chan. Thank you so much for your research. Encourage people to learn CPR. See if you can get a class and all the rest of it. Save lives. Save lives. Thank you so much. And we will just continue the discussion with your colleague. But thank you so much. Keep up the outstanding work. We will look forward to new information from you, sir.
Thank you so much for your time and for highlighting this important topic. And I'll let Anessi, who's very eloquent on this topic, take it from here.
The Cows, Dr. Paul S. Chan. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Tuesday evening with us. We will be in touch, sir. Wow. Great information. That's all I can say as we transition. I put that as the title. I was thinking of this report. Black people, non-white people, less likely to get CPR if this had happened to Damar Hamlin and he had not been in the stadium. I think Dr. Chan verified that component of it, but just in general, people who have these sort of cardiac events, it's about 90% of the folks. That is it. Wow. Anywho, wow, since we're doing full disclosure for the program, as we transition, so Dr. Paul S. Chan, who we just heard from, he is not the lead author for the report that we just been talking about, Racial and Ethnic Differences in Bystander CPR for Witnessed Cardiac Arrest. So I asked him to be a guest on the program. He says, sure, let's do it. I says, you know, how long do you need me to stay? I said, our program is East Coast, 8 to 10. If you can stay for the full time, that's great. If not, it's not a problem. He says, well, I think I can only do about 45 minutes or so, but my colleague, he would be happy to join us. And so he sent me his colleague's contact, or he forwarded his colleague's contact information. And I didn't see his name on the study that we were talking about. And I was like, what in the world? Like, is this, he's got some random like grad student or whatever, who's not even associated with the report. That's what I thought at first. Then I said, well, wait a minute. Let me go see, you know, who this guy is, since he's sending me this person's name. I looked and I was like, oh, wow. He is the, I think, lead author for the report, Make Basic Life Support Basic, a novel virtual hands-only CPR training program in minority school age youth. October 2021. I said, wow, that is amazing. And it is. Just wow. I am super appreciative. And not even just that report. It was that one. And then Black Lives Matter in the Cath Lab 2, a proposal for the interventional cardiology community to counteract bias and racism. Don't even find too many reports that put racism specifically in the title. But wow, I thought it would be grand. We get even more information and just continue this really important topic and maybe encourage more folks get CPR training. See if you can get it at, you know, wherever, the YMCA, if they have a community center, church, any place that can hold a large number of people, so you can get lots of folks, especially lots of Black people, non-white people, victims of racism, CPR trained. So thankful to have our second guest on the program today, continuing this really important subject matter, author of several of the reports, co-author, the reports that I just named, joining us live, Dr. Anezi Uzindu. Dr. Uzindu, are you with us, sir?
Hi, I am. Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me. Can you guys hear me okay?
Crystal, can you hear us okay, sir?
Yes, I can.
Awesome.
Yeah, thank you so much. I mean, it was great, even just, you know, kind of, I think the last 10 or 15 minutes or so, I got a chance to, you know, finish listening to Dr. Chan, and you know, I work with him every day, but it's always great to kind of hear his wealth of knowledge and expertise in this area, and to have people really kind of pushing and try and make sure that, you know, that people know CPR, that people survive cardiac arrest events. And so I'm glad to be able to kind of dovetail what, you know, some of what you talked about and talk a little bit about my experience. And I think further reemphasize how important it is for people to know CPR and be able to save a life. And I'm so grateful that you are, you know, taking this on and, you know, I'm sharing this with your community, our community, really, to make sure that we're able to save lives.
Indeed. Dr. Chan, when he was doing his intro, he was talking about you and he said, Damar Hamlin, he had this event, cardiac arrest on the football field. And when Dr. Uzindu, when he gets here, he can tell you about his incident of cardiac arrest on the basketball court. I was like, dude, what? What in the world? Like, I did not see. What is he talking about?
Exactly so. Yeah, you know, kind of. I guess I'll give you a little bit of my backstory. So, my name is Anezi Uzindu. I was born and raised in St. Louis. My parents were originally from Nigeria, hence the name. But yeah, kind of born and raised here. Bounced around with training, you know, high school and everything in St. Louis. And then came to Kansas City and did undergraduate and medical school. You know, Black kid, loved sports, loved basketball specifically. Was never good enough, I think, to, you know, make it, you know, I think, you know, really pursue my hoop dreams. But I mean, even in med school, you know, the night before a test for me to kind of cool and calm down, you know, you're going to see me on a basketball court. You know, that's kind of just where I found peace. Felt like I felt community, all that sort of stuff. So, I mean, I was playing basketball 3-4 times a week. And so graduated medical school, and kind of the way training happens is you know, there's medical school, then there's like residency, which is kind of on the job training where you're really kind of starting to specialize a little bit into what you're going to be doing. And I did that in Birmingham, Alabama. And while I was there in my third year, I decided I wanted to go on and actually do a little bit more training in cardiology. And so I just got done interviewing across the country, you know, different places, trying to figure out where would be the best fit for me to do 3 years of cardiology training. And I went to, you know, had a long day at work, you know, kind of took care of the patients on the floor. And then went to my local Gold's Gym and played ball like I always would. But had a cardiac arrest, you know, dropped there. I mean, I don't really remember the day at this point. I remember like bits and pieces of, you know, I think earlier in the day, but really don't remember playing, even though I was told I was having an amazing game. You know, dropped there on the court. And I mean, I was 25 years old, so a year older than Damar Hamlin was when this happened. And, you know, like Dr. Chan said, I mean, it is very, very rare unfortunately, for a black male to receive bystander CPR. And I mean, it's still kind of, you know, and especially in Birmingham, Alabama, kind of just a random gym. This wasn't, you know, a televised NFL game where you got, you know, thousands of people in the stands and things like that. This is just, you know, your local community center, right? But those, like, that's where we are. Those are the places that we live. You know, we're in the barbershop in the community center where, you know, we're just, you know, living life. And these are the places where these events happen. These are the places where we need to be ready. You know, I'm so grateful. I thank God so much that people there were ready, you know, and so I've dropped, you know, people recognized I was actually having a cardiac arrest, started CPR. There was a defibrillator at the gym that they were able to use to try and shock my heart back into rhythm. I was very, very sick for some reason. I mean, they shocked me multiple times at the gym. You know, the ambulance came to pick me up in the ambulance, multiple shocks. I got to the ED. I still didn't get my pulse back. You know, Damar Hamlin, he had his pulse back still on the field. You know, for me, I still didn't get a pulse back until, you know, I think 13 rounds in the ED. And so just really, really, really bad cardiac arrest, really sick at the time. But again, everything, things that don't happen, unfortunately, you know, all lined up for me to be able to make truly, truly, again, a miraculous recovery. Again, like that 8 to 10% of people surviving are a lot of times people that drop, you know, they get shocked or they get a little bit of CPR and they bounce back up. It's not the, you know, your heart stops for 20, 30 minutes. It's just not coming back and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, very, very blessed to, you know, to be here and stuff. But I was sick for a while. You know, I was in the ICU for about 3 weeks or so. Then I was discharged and was able to kind of do some rehab and all that sort of stuff and get back to, you know, get back to finish my training, go on to do the cardiology training. I talked about my event a lot of times really kind of just from a spiritual standpoint and, you know, kind of like the church members and, you know, family members and things like that. But then I saw an event happen that really messed with me. And this was, I think, in 2018 or so, where, you know, it was actually NBA, you know, there was the NBA D League, which I guess is now called the G League. There was a player in the G League and I was looking at his birthday. I think he was born like a few days after me, like May 28th or something like that, 1991. NBA G League player, again, you know, I think it was like the fourth quarter of the game, drops, has a cardiac arrest. And this is like I think it's like locally televised. Again, it's like a smaller team and stuff. But he has this cardiac arrest and, you know, it's on camera and you see no one doing CPR, you know, with Damar Hamlin, people rush on the field, all that sort of stuff. That game, like, you know, the video is still on YouTube. And I mean, when I tell you, I was just shook, you know, I couldn't, like, I mean, I still can't get over it, but seeing him drop and people not knowing what to do when you have a whole team, there's supposed to be physicians, there are people in the crowd, no one recognized it, no one treated anything, you know, a day or two later, you know, he was pronounced dead. It rocked me, you know, and I felt like, you know, I got to benefit. I got to live not because of, you know, my own strength or all that sort of stuff or how smart I am or how athletic I thought I was or anything like that. You know, I was just blessed to have people around me that knew CPR, knew how to use a defibrillator, all that sort of stuff. And it was almost selfish of me in a sense to not make sure that I'm not like that, you know, that I'm not paying it forward for other people so that other people can have a chance to live or survive an event like mine, you know? And so after that, I was really like, you know, I'm already in cardiology. You know, I kind of now can look at things from both sides, you know, from a patient standpoint, then as a cardiologist and really try and see are there ways I can affect my community and make sure that, you know, other people have a chance to live and, in situations where a lot of times we're not. And so that was kind of the impetus for trying to figure out, all right, let's see if there are ways that we can kind of train and make sure that people know CPR. And so the whole premise behind Make BLS Basic was, you know, BLS is basic life support. But we kind of think of, you know, anything that's basic, you think about basic education, basic human rights, all those things are like ubiquitous in the community. Like everyone feels comfortable doing it. It's basic, right? But basic life support doesn't seem basic. You know, people don't feel comfortable doing it. People don't know how to do it. And so the goal of the program was to make basic life support truly basic so that everyone feels that they're able and comfortable doing, you know, kind of having this skill set. And we kind of did actually in the height of the COVID pandemic, which is when we realized that, and unfortunately, like, it was kind of the worst, I think, all world in a sense, for multiple different reasons, obviously COVID and all the things that were happening on during that time. But training, you know, all the training facilities and all that sort of stuff kind of shut down with the pandemic. But at the same time, the incidence or the numbers for cardiac arrest were actually increasing because COVID was driving it. People that were having heart disease and things like that weren't coming in on time until they had a cardiac arrest. So there were higher cardiac arrest numbers, but lower interventions or lower people than even before that knew how to intervene and provide CPR. And so we kind of created this virtual training program where we kind of partnered with some people in the community, students, and a kind of after school program for predominantly kind of Black and Hispanic students in the Boston area. And we, you know, got them little kits that they could learn on, and on kind of a Zoom platform, we talked about what CPR was, what cardiac arrest was, how it's different from a heart attack, the importance of doing CPR, things like that. Broke into small groups. They did the chest compressions and got to practice on the mannequins. And then, you know, the hope was hopefully they'd be able to take that to their families, you know, and kind of continue to train more people and stuff. And that was kind of the first really, I think that was the first step that I truly did on my own, trying to see how can, you know, how can we make this better? How can other people in my community benefit from, you know, what I got to benefit from? Oh, sorry, that was a long-winded answer, but I think summarized kind of how I got to be here.
Dr. Uzindu, a pre now, man, I would be remiss. We are one day removed from the official Dr. King holiday. I think he did say the Birmingham, where he had his cardiac event, was in Birmingham. Like, wow, for sure, connection to MLK. Wow, that is stunning on many accounts. What was the name of the basketball player who was in the, I guess, developmental league, who, I guess, died on the court, I guess?
Yeah, his name was Zeke Upshaw, Z-E-K-E, and then Upshaw, U-P-S-H-A-W.
Okay, I will. Black male privilege. Wow. I don't even know what to say. I mean, the NBA, this is like a billion-dollar conglomerate, and I know the G League or Developmental League, I know that's not the NBA, but I mean, are you serious? You don't have one person in a full, or not even have to be full, but in a game where I'm sure it was more than 50 people present, not
right.
One person.
Right.
No, like, black male privilege. And matter of fact, even pause right there, because that's the exact same that when scholars, people who have much more credentials, are lauded than myself, when they come out and say the concept black male privilege, they say that it's athletes. Damar Hamlin, these fellas, Zeke Upshaw, they can go out and make a living playing these sports and ball games and what have you, that's one component of black male privilege, brain damage and all. Did I hear earlier when we were talking about all this, when you said you had your cardiac arrest and you dropped down, did you say black males, that they're the most likely to get CPR from a bystander if they should have some sort of unfortunate cardiac
absolutely
event?
Absolutely not. Yeah, absolutely not. No, we are not.
Dang. Zeke Upshaw. Zeke Upshaw. That is disgraceful. He said it's on the video. Oh, that is so disgraceful. We just talked about Hank Gathers too. Are you familiar with Hank Gathers? Do you know who that is?
Yeah. I mean, that was kind of, you know, a bit before I, you know, knew of all this, but yeah, it was terrible as well.
Long legacy of just black male privilege died right on the, just talked about that in Mahmoud Abdul Rauf's autobiography. I guess all of that, in my view, is the product of the system of racism, white supremacy. Use the term racism right in your report on Black Lives Matter in the CAT lab as well, which hopefully we'll be able to talk about. What is your definition? What do you mean when you use the term racism?
Yeah, I mean, oh man, yeah. So I'll start off by saying, you know, like I'm a doctor and I've studied medicine, and so you know, this isn't necessarily a sense that, you know, I didn't study race or anything like that in school, so I'm not a scholar by any means, but we've lived it, you know, and I think for all the scholarship and all that sort of stuff, like I think there's something else about kind of living through that experience, you know. When we were talking about like some of the, you know, I kind of came in on the tail end of that unconscious bias, and I thought about, you know, like unconscious and conscious biases I've gone through. I mean, there are things that I've been called on, you know, I remember as a kid, you know, 1990s, which, you know, most people think, oh, like, you know, the world was good by then, all that sort of stuff. And I remember as a kid, things that I was called as a 6-7-year-old in St. Louis, you know, in the South County, kind of predominantly white suburbs of St. Louis, you know. I remember growing up in high school and not being able to get a job. You know, like I was like, what, you know, kind of what credentials do you need to get a job at McDonald's? You know, like why can't I, as a, I guess a black kid with a funny name, get a job at McDonald's or the mall or all the other places that my other friends in high school were able to get jobs, you know? I mean, I remember one summer I applied to just about every store in the mall, to McDonald's. I got rejected from McDonald's twice, to wash dishes at a hospital, all that sort of stuff, you know? And these are like, I mean, what, like, I wanted just a little bit of money to buy myself new basketball shoes. Cause again, basketball is the only thing I want. I wanted to be able to play basketball, buy a little court, like a little thing in my backyard, $150 to, you know, play basketball. Like, and I wasn't able to do it. And yeah, I think there were a lot of times growing up where it was conscious. It was that person knew they did not want a black person. They didn't want someone looking like me in, you know, or was in the workplace or whatever the case was. You know, I got to medical school and I started seeing things that were, I felt like were more, maybe not necessarily conscious, but maybe they were unconscious, you know, and, you know, sometimes you're not able to really say, you know, you can't really say someone's motivations and stuff. But in medical school, I know, like, I had a 3.8-3.9 GPA, you know, like, I was doing really good in medical school. It was in my second to last semester of, like, science classes, and then it was going to move on to clinicals. And we had these standardized patient interviews. So you just, you know, you go in, you know, you have a patient, like a fake patient that's, it was basically an actor that's supposed to, maybe they're supposed to act like they're angry. They're supposed to act like, you know, they're tired or, you know, there's some sort of, you know, act that they put on, and you're supposed to really just kind of communicate. And it's a class based on communication. I had a white lady that was, said that, you know, she was the angry patient. And I went in, I introduced myself, and then, you know, I addressed. So she's angry. I addressed her anger. She said in my evaluation that she felt that I was insincere. And because of that, she failed me. Ended up failing because of how she failed and marked my grade, I failed the whole course. Like, someone that was a 3.8-3.9 GPA on his way for, you know, honors and all that sort of stuff, medical school, I ended up going on probation for a year. If I had any trouble, if I had real trouble with science class or something that had an ABC, you know, type of exam, and I fail a true exam objectively, I would have been kicked out of the program. But just like that, on academic probation, every single time till date, if I apply for a license, that shows up that, oh, he was on academic probation because a young white lady said that a young black man responding to her, she felt it was insincere. And I think the problem I had with it was that this is where, even if explicitly, maybe she doesn't, you know, maybe she's not racist, maybe she doesn't feel like I'm just going to mark this guy bad because he's a black man. I think people not understanding their unconscious biases or their unconscious racism, that things that may, that are unconscious, that are even kind of below their level of thinking, but things that maybe they've been, they've seen and portrayed in media, and all of these sorts of things have kind of created this image of a Black man in their mind that is inaccurate. And they can't, when they meet a Black man, those things, those reactions, those reflexes come out and they don't check it. Like, why is it that being in a Black, in a room with a Black man makes you feel that whatever they're saying is untrustworthy? Like, why should that reaction or that reflex go unchecked, unchecked, and, you know, cause me harm, you know, right? And so it's very, very interesting, you know, obviously, like, as, and that goes on to, you know, I mean, there's so many more implications of that, right? So many Black students that go through, you know, Black students aren't able to, you know, perform as well. You know, why are we having affirmative action and all that sort of stuff? Because, you know, we're not getting the best because, you know, a Black man went through medical school and he has probation, whereas he went on probation while the other students didn't. But it's not because the Black man wasn't doing well, but because there are all these things, there are systems, there are people, there are just that, you know, again, for, you know, a 400-year history have been honest. And so it's very troubling. And then that goes on to play with, you know, that plays on with how patients are treated in the hospital, a lot of different interactions. And I think, you know, I think the reason why we're really, there is kind of this new stress on unconscious bias or unconscious racism is because there are a lot of people in power that truly do not believe that they're racist. And I think, and I believe they believe that. And, you know, they don't like feel like, oh, I want to treat a Black man or a Black woman differently than someone else. Like that's inherently not in them. But there are these reflexes. There are these traits that they've kind of picked up over time from media, from socialization, things their grandparents said, whatever the case is, their friend circles that are predominantly white and they never see Black people, they never interact with, like that do have effects on us. And so trying to tell them, hey, you know, like, you just not saying I hate Black people or thinking you hate Black people doesn't mean you're not harming us. That some of these reflexes, some of these ways that you reflexively perceive us can cause harm because you act on it, and that changes things and that makes things worse. And that's the reason why you prescribe this medication for this person, but not for this person. That's the reason why you think when, you know, Black person comes in and says they have pain, you don't really treat or you don't think it's real, but someone else comes in with pain and you give them adequate pain medication. Like those reflexes that you've learned are causing harm. And so, sorry, again, I'm going on tangents, but I think racism and how that plays in education, how that plays a role in healthcare and medicine is very complex and convoluted. But I think the first step is, you know, people truly kind of understanding that just because it's not explicit, just because you don't identify as being racist doesn't mean that you're not having reactions, you're not having reflexes that are harming us. And you need to check that, you need to learn that, and question your reflexes to make sure you're treating people appropriately.
Context of white supremacy. Indeed, Dr. Anezi Uzindu, man, show me state indeed. That is another heaping teaspoon of Black male privilege. He says, I have to have this on my record for the rest of my life. I was on academic probation because a white woman thought I was insincere and sassy and talking to her. Like, what in the world? Like, 3-9 honor student to you are on the cusp of being booted. Like, Black male privilege. I have two questions. One, I don't know if it's a question, more of an observation. One, he just 3-9 honor student, like, wow, lots of brilliant folks visiting the cows today.
No need to be humble with us, sir. 3-9 honor student. Nothing else need be said. Many people do not have like a definition of racism. Just for listeners, very important, because I didn't really hear a definition. And you said, hey, you were very honest. I'm a doctor, cardiologist. I'm not a race scholar. No problem. but I didn't really hear a definition. So if you don't have one, that's fine too. But with your, because that was one of my questions that you hopped ahead of, I was going to ask you if you could give us an incident of med school racism. And I mean, wow, that is a double whopper. what were the demographics when you were doing your med school in terms of your students and then your professors, white, non-white?
All right. Yeah, I don't have a great definition. I would really say that it's, I'd say racism is the use of race to inform your opinions and your actions on someone, you know? And we know that race it's a social construct. There's no biology that's set to it. There's not a black gene or a white gene or something like that. And your preconceived notions of someone's race has no bearing on who they truly are and what they do. And so using that or being informed, truly trying to be, you know, I guess being informed by someone's race and acting on it, especially when you have negative actions and negative you know, premeditations based on someone's race. But again, not a race scholar or anything like that. So take my definition with a lot of salt. The demographics as far as my medical school and education, my medical school class was, I think, a little over 100 people. We had 3 black males and a few black women in my original medical school class. Of that original medical school class of maybe, let's say, 8 of us, and again, out of 100 or so students, I think only 2 of us graduated on time. And the 2 of us that graduated, I'll tell you, myself and 1 other black male, both of us were failed by that same standardized patient, that same angry patient. He also didn't have any trouble throughout medical school, didn't have any problems till we got to that class. And then, you know, we got those, quote unquote, you know, got on probation, all that because of that class. And so in my medical school class, I'm thinking, I really want to be entirely sure, but I don't think there was any black student in my class that got out unscathed from my original class. And then from medical school professors, there was 1 black male I knew of. He never taught it, like, and he wasn't one of like the kind of the way medical school is split. You have kind of classes in your first, you know, few years that are, you know, kind of classroom work. And then the last few years are based in the hospital. And so he did some of the hospital based stuff, but he wasn't in kind of the classroom. So in the classroom portion of medical school, I never had a black teacher. And then he was there for kind of rotations in the hospital. But I never interacted with him. And so, I never had any, black instructors. And I mean, my medical school may have been partly an exception, maybe, they had a system of, to me, a system of potentially, you know, keeping black students down, where, you know, only 2 of us graduated on time, and we still, both of us had academic marks on us because of that, the standardized patient interaction. It's really troubling. I mean, and it's very hard now as a physician kind of in these academic spaces. You know, I mean, I've trained at Harvard. I've trained at all the bigger programs now, you know, schools and all that sort of stuff. And there are all these philosophical debates of, you know, are black students good enough? you know, or like, why are we, there's truly a lot of discussion about this. You know, why is there affirmative action? Like, there are people that are more deserving, that are better, that should be in these positions. There's actually a doctor that kind of wrote this huge, large article on this. He ended up getting in trouble because of the article, but initially it was accepted and published in, you know, one of the top journals about how he felt like, you know, with affirmative action, we're just basically getting bad doctors out into the community. But like my story, stories like mine and my friends, where it's like, yes, on a piece of paper now, it would show, oh yeah, in this medical school class, you know, there were these guys, these black students weren't able to keep up or keep on track, when it truly is a system, or it's racism that is causing the problem, that is causing the problem. And instead, you guys are seeing it as a deficiency in us. And so I'm hoping, you know, there are a lot of people that are kind of starting to understand and really think, hear some of these stories. I think this, you know, what has happened over the last 2 years as far as just racial, I won't even call it reconciliation, but I think there's at least been more discussion. And hopefully that continues to kind of move the needle. And you kind of said, like with MLK Day yesterday, you know, it was just, hopefully each generation continues to kind of push the envelope and eradicate some of these injustices that we're seeing.
The cows, context of white supremacy. I just want to make sure I got my figures correct for your med school demographics, because we certainly put this in the context of J. Marion Sims, Medical Apartheid, Harriet A. Washington, top 10. Ugh. So he says his med school experience, out of about 100 students, seems like approximately 8 of them were black, 3 black males. Out of that 8 black people, 2 on time, he and one other black male, both on academic probation, failed for the same class, being insincere, sassy, I guess, with this white woman actor. He said for professors, he had 0 black teachers, and I cracked up laughing. He said he heard of a black male instructor. I said, man, is this Sasquatch, a unicorn? Like, we heard he's around here. I've not actually taken a class from him, but rumor has it he hangs out by the water cooler every other month just for 5 minutes. Black male teacher. If I got my figures correct, like, and that's the sort of thing we've asked, particularly when we had Julie M. Stam on. We were talking about Damar Hamlin. She is a neuroscientist. Julie M. Stam is a white woman. And I asked her, your colleagues, folks that you were with, and she also did not say, oh, yeah, we're just overrun. It's just black people everywhere, black males and black females. Just no. Particularly, she did some of her neuroscience work at Harvard. So, absolutely, hey, Boston area, absolutely not. That sort of thing, and because it's been generations of that, you can see why many people would say it seems like this is deliberate. Like you said, it seems like they have a system. Like, even if we have brilliant black males, hardworking, dedicated, Dr. Uzendu wants to get out here and do great work, 3.9 on his way to being an honors med school graduate. And I think he's, and it'd always be some vague, like, what? How do you prove that someone is insincere? Like, if this is calculus and you say the answer is 2, like, that's real simple. Like, hey, let's see, is it 2, yes or no? Like, real simple. But this Negro male is insincere. And then for it to happen twice, like, what? And then we don't even know what happened to the other 6. Like, who knows? Are they insincere too? Or, you know, you can see why we would think, or some would think, like, dang, it seems like this is not unconscious at all. It seems like this is just J. Marion Sims' deliberate white supremacy racism. What do you think, Dr. Uzendu?
Yeah, you know, I mean, that's the million-dollar question, because, you know, ultimately we can't read people's minds. It's tough. It's very, very tough. When I was going through that process, at first I was just like, this can't be right. You know, when I saw the failing, I was like, you know, this must have been a mistake, you know, then I started kind of writing appeal letters. I went through the appeal process because I was like this isn't right, you know? I remember talking to my dad about it, and my dad dealt with, so he was immigrant, came to the States, you know, in the '80s, and dealt with a lot of racism and stuff. And he has his own stories, but, you know, he was basically like, you know, like, don't put your hope in these appeals, you know, like, you know, try if you feel like you need to try to, you know, make yourself, you know, but he's like, don't put your hope in these appeals. Like, this system, basically, like, the system wasn't made for you, you know? And, you know, again, I'd had some, you know, things that happened as a kid, you know, like, yeah, not being able to get a job, being called some names, all sorts. I was like, no, like, you know, like, there's an appeal system, like, this thing's going to work out, this and that, blah, blah. And I start going down this appeal pathway, and I'm sending appeals in, and I'm getting my appeal denied, and I ask for a reason for the appeal to be, the reason why the appeal is denied, and they say, oh, we don't have to give you a reason. I go, oh, interesting. Okay. You know, I write the next one. Hey, can you give me a reason? Oh, no, we denied it, but we don't have to give you a reason. It got to the level of the dean. And for the dean, I asked, I was like, I don't even want a decision. You know, I just want to be able to meet with you in person and talk to you about this. They said it's not required for the protocol for her to meet with me. And she denies the decision. Denies the appeal. And, you know, I think if it wasn't that, I think my dad, and I think honestly, a lot of us Black people, like, I think we do this to protect our family, protect the people we love that are navigating through this world where it's like, this system a lot of times is not made for you. And if you really think that you're going to succeed, or if you're going to maybe necessarily have an equal fair shot, and you're putting it open that, like, you'll really, really be crushed. And I think in that moment when I realized, oh, like, this appeal system, like, they can reject my appeal and not give me a reason, this and that, like, I started seeing my dad has been through this, and he was, I guess, watching me kind of be introduced to what American can do to a Black man, and was trying to protect me from that. And, you know, I think about that for my kids too. Like, is this what, you know, is this what parenting will continue to be, that, you know, you have a child and you try and protect them and say, hey, you know, people talk about the talk and, you know, if you get pulled over, this and that, but, you know, basically training our children to be strong, to be unshakable, regardless of injustices and things being around them. You know, there's this clip I saw where she, a woman was saying, you know, you guys are complimenting me for being a strong Black woman, but she's like, I don't want to have to be strong. I don't want to have to be strong. And I think about that. Yes, there are things I'm having to do, and my dad had to do for me. You know, we had to be strong Black men, but I want my son to be a strong Black man, my future daughter to be a strong Black woman, but I don't want them to have to be able to navigate this world, navigate these systems. So hopefully we continue to push, continue to have these conversations and change the dynamic.
The context of white supremacy, what advice, we have even some of our listeners who Black females in med school, what advice would you give to Black med school student or aspiring Black med school student for the racism that they are going to encounter, things that maybe you wish you had known that would help you deal with that racism and that environment to help you get through it as best you can?
Yeah. I would say the first thing is kind of building a community, you know, talk to other Black, you know, try and reach out to other Black students, Black physicians that have gone through it, you know, particularly in your institution, but I think creating that network, creating that fellowship, I think is very important because they're able to kind of navigate things and, you know, they've been through it and they're able to kind of tell you what they've seen. Some of the biggest tests and things like that, like I didn't know, oh, look, this is very important, or this is, you know, and I thank God I continue to do well in those things. But I am the first physician in my family. And so there was no blueprint. There wasn't a way that I'd seen this done. And I didn't have any other friends that were doing it or anything like that. No one from my high school was and things like that. And so I think, you know, I don't want to say it sets us at a disadvantage, but there are a lot of people that say you can't be what you haven't seen, you know, what you can't see. And so I think trying to make sure once you kind of get into these circles that you do have mentorship, that you have other people around you that can kind of show you the potholes, show you, hey, you know, watch this or try and take this or try and, you know, make the most out of this opportunity, would be the number one thing I'd say to aspiring students or current students. You know.
Awesome. Awesome. Let's see. Let me make sure I get some of our folks who dialed in with questions. Our caller 0356. 0356. Did you have a question for Dr. Uzindu? You should be with us as well. 0356.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Greetings to Gus, the host, callers and listeners, and Dr. Uzindu. Thank you for all your constructive information tonight that you're sharing with us, and just your dedication to saving lives and health. I wanted to ask a question in your professional opinion in regards to a term I've been hearing. What is your definition of unconscious, if you don't mind?
I would say unconscious is things that you're not like aware of, to be honest with you. So they may be there, they're in your brain. They may affect you, but it's going on unconsciously. You know, you kind of think about, let's say, breathing. You know, right now that I talk about breathing, you are thinking of it, right? And you're like, now you're thinking about breathing in, breathing out. But, you know, within a few seconds, within a few minutes, you're not going to think about your breathing. You're still doing it. But it's happening without you having to consciously think about it. And so I think there are things that we do, just like breathing, that we don't necessarily have to be thinking of or, you know, be intentional about, but that that are actions that obviously can cause both good and bad outcomes.
Thank you, sir. In your medical opinion, and I'm asking this for my question to you about the system of racism and white supremacy, but in your medical opinion, do you think that the practice of racism can substantially be done unconsciously? Or, yes, that's my question. Thank you. Can it be done substantially unconsciously and to be a practice? And I'm your doubt. Thank you for your time, sir.
Yeah, it's a really good question. I do think so. I think honestly, I'm thinking about everything I've said now. Maybe I may sound pessimistic in a sense, but I truly am an optimist, and I truly do try to see the good in people or give people, I think, the best. I think, you know, think the best of them and think that, you know, they're trying to do good and trying to, treat people fairly. I think just maybe that overall outlook. There have been conversations I've had, where I start realizing that, you know, when you have a conversation, you break some of these things down, you know, you see an action that you don't think is quite right. and then you have a conversation with someone, you start, you know, I think you have enough conversations with enough people, you start realizing that they may not know, like they truly may not know, like, oh, like this just like that doesn't make sense. Or like, oh, like that, that is not the right way to handle a situation or approach someone. There's this, I think it'd be interesting, you know, I think you should potentially take it. But there's a implicit bias test. I think it's actually on, I think like a Harvard website, I think it's called the IAT or something like that. But you could just Google this and you can take this test and it tells you what your implicit biases are. And so, you know, you'll see a picture and you have to kind of immediately do like kind of a word association thing. And it's a, you know, you kind of get done like, oh, this, you know, you just kind of see all these frames really quickly, you quickly kind of reflexively put the word association option that you have. And at the end of this test, it kind of spits out what your biases are. And it's very, very informative. You know, you kind of go through this, you start realizing that, I mean, I have I can't remember some of the results of mine, but I do have like, there are implicit biases that I have. Now, they may not necessarily be race-based, like there are other categories, but there are reflexes and stereotypes. Some of it might be from, you know, different traumas that we've seen or things that we've kind of been through that, again, reflexively we treat people or we have the tendency to treat people a certain way. And I don't think that the reflex thought is wrong, but acting on it is. And so if you see someone or you kind of interact with someone and like immediately there's this, you know, like a reflex, that I don't think the reflex is a problem, but letting that go unchecked without saying, hey, kind of thinking through like, why do I think this way? Or why do I assume this about this person? And then rationally kind of going through and making sure, or you're kind of thinking the opposite. If I was in a different situation, or if this is a different person, would I react differently or would this reflex be different? You know, I think kind of going through that, you know, that test and that exercise, I realized that I think all of us do have some implicit or other words like unconscious kind of biases. But we know how, I think part of it's power. You know, we may not be in powerful positions to be able to act on it or, you know, hurt people with it. And then I think a lot of us are very conscious of, oh, like that's a reflex, but it's not substantive. It's not for a good reason. And so because of that, I can, you know that this is the wrong way to act. I should move differently. And so I think that definitely plays a role in a lot of what happens in medicine. But there is, you know, that explicit or the conscious racism does exist. You know, I think there are times where it's very clear this is conscious racism, you know, and then there are times that you can't tell, to be honest with you. And in those settings, it's still that does, because it's unconscious, it doesn't leave, that person isn't off the hook. You know, if I'm saying that the lady that thought I was insincere, you know, potentially her bias is unconscious. And because of that, all this has happened to me. I don't think she's off the hook for that. I think she and the system shouldn't allow someone's unconscious bias or unconscious racism to be propagated to the point that it can harm someone else. And so I think that's an individual problem that she needs to check. And a system should be able to check and say, hey, could this be a biased opinion or a biased assessment? And if that's the case, then how do we rectify it? And so I think that's a lot of kind of what happens in medicine and education. I think a lot of different spheres in life.
Much obliged to our caller at 0356, retired firefighter in Florida. Retired firefighter in Florida. Did you have a question for Dr. Uzindu? You should be with us.
Yes. Greetings, Doc. My question is within middle schools, high schools. Why do you think, should they have first aid courses in these public schools? You know, a early teenager can apply a tourniquet in the right place, CPR, can even operate a AED, the ones that are put in public places, especially. That's the one I'm talking about. And shouldn't it be, you know, EMT level or first aid level courses in public schools? And if so, why do you think they don't have courses in first aid?
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you for that. You know, so interestingly enough, you know, in the last decade, there's been a lot of change. Really in the last, I'd say since about 2011, 2012, there was actually a lot of legislation that was passed across the country. And so 40 out of 50 states now mandate some sort of CPR training before high school graduation. So sometime between 7th and 12th grade, they need, from one of the states, I'm talking, because every single state's a little bit different, which brings up the problem, which I'll talk about here in a second. But 40 states have some sort of law that says there needs to be some sort of CPR education before high school graduation. Now, the problem is a law that doesn't necessarily provide resources or mandate assessments or proficiency, you know, how effective is that law, right? And so if you just kind of pass this law, but you have a school that's already, you have teachers that are already overworked, that don't have the resources, that aren't funded to be able to do this. How effective can that be? Or let's say they do have this, you know, mandate, and they go and they figure out a way to train or teach, and it's one time in seventh grade and it's really quick. Maybe they kind of show a video and all that sort of stuff, you know, 2-3 years down the line, how much of that do they remember? Are you really equipping people to be able to help save lives, or are we kind of checking a box that, well, they got some sort of education at some point? I think the laws, you know, I'm grateful for the laws. I think that they made a big step. But I think, you know, the thought that now that, you know, 40 out of 50 states now have a law, we're good. I don't think that's necessarily the case. And actually, kind of the next step in my research is really trying to figure out how effective have these laws been, and then how equitable have they been, right? And so if I'm passing a law and, you know, the prep school down the street that has all the money, has all the resources, can get great trainers, all the mannequins, all that sort of stuff, and then, you know, the public school in the inner city doesn't have the resources, they play a short video, everyone practices on one mannequin or whatever the case is, is that what's happening? Are we still kind of, in a sense, we're continuing to propagate these disparities because we're not providing resources in an equitable manner, and this training in an equitable manner? You know, I don't know the answers to those questions, but I think there's still work to be done, even though in a lot of states now it is mandated for CPR education to happen. I think we still need to do more.
Yes. Well, last question. Most of these quote unquote inner cities have large fire departments. Would one of the answers to, I think one of the statements that you made, a question that you brought up, could be fixed by hiring firefighters to train high school and middle school students on some of these things? Wouldn't that be a good idea?
That'd be excellent. No, I think that would be excellent. I mean, you know, firefighters, EMTs, like, you know, they have the training, to have the experience, able to connect. I think, you know, I think that would be awesome. That would be phenomenal. And that's a good, I mean, I didn't even, you know, in thinking about how to kind of navigate this problem, I'd never even thought of that. But, yeah, I mean, using what's, you know, using the people, the expertise, the specialists in the community, will be a great way to start helping to solve the problems that we're seeing.
Yes, sir. And thank you for coming on the program.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for the question.
Let's see. In your service. Indeed. Let's see. Matter of fact, the great Governor Ron DeSantis, 2024, Governor of Florida, he signed a bill in 2021 making it mandatory for high school students in the state of Florida to take CPR training before they graduate. Our caller 2262, did you have a question for Dr. Uzindu? You should be with us. Or he already asked a question for Dr. Chan, so second time around.
Yes, thank you so much for coming back to me, Gus. And greetings, Dr. Uzindu. Thank you again for sharing your knowledge with us. My question for you is, are you familiar with the Olympic shot?
Not as familiar. No.
I'm sorry. That's not the wrong. It's Ozempic. It is the weight loss shot.
Oh, gotcha. Yeah, I think, I mean, I've seen it. It's not necessarily something that I prescribe just because I do interventional cardiology specifically, and so kind of treat people with heart attacks. But I know it's kind of a diet and weight loss drug. I think it's also used in diabetes.
Okay, well, I'll just move on. I'll just ask, do you have any tips for possible medical students who are Black as far as when it comes to studying techniques? And I'll mute my line. Thank you again, guys.
Yeah, that's a great question. What I've kind of advised people to do is whatever strategy, you know, especially with medical students, what I tell them is whatever strategy you typically do, do that, but do that 100%, like go all out before the first test, right? And then when that first test comes, if you do great, then you do great. You can keep that strategy, keep going. If that first test comes and you don't do well, then you know it wasn't an effort problem, right? You already went 100% with your strategy. And so now you know for the second test, I need to change strategy. I need to try something else, new strategy, and I'll go 100% with that. The problem is when you get to that first test and you didn't give it 100%, you didn't give it full effort to begin with, and you don't do well. If you don't do well at that point, you don't know whether it's a strategy problem or an effort problem. And so now the second test, maybe now you increase your effort. Now your effort's 100% or whatever the case is. And that's when you realize, oh, I still didn't work. And that's a strategy problem. And now you have two bad tests. You're getting to your third pass. You know, now you're at your third test, which who knows, might be the end of the semester. You get into a final, whatever the case is, and you're running into trouble. And so the best way to do that, go all out with whatever strategy you have on your first test. If that works, you stick with it. If it doesn't work, you know it's not an effort problem. You know it's not, you know, intensity problem, but a strategy problem, and you can switch strategies for the next test. I think ultimately kind of every class, every person has a different strategy that may end up working for them. But I think if you approach it that way, you kind of have a like almost an algorithm to increase your chances to succeed.
Awesome. Great suggestions, Dr. Uzindu. I asked about the, or I guess one for folks, if you have a question for Dr. Uzindu, the number is 605-313-5164, the code 564-943, pound, press star 61. If you have a question, don't wait till the last moment. I asked about med school and your students and what have you. Now that you are a cardiologist official, and even that, like, he went from just trying to wash dishes at the hospital to being a cardiologist. Like, wow, that is amazing. With cardiac arrest in between, like, wow, you should write a book. What are the demographics of your other cardiologists?
Yes, I mean, right now I'm in a very small practice. So I think there's only like 5 or 6 cardiologists in the practice in total. And so I'm the only black one. But I'm moving to a larger academic center. And when I move there, then it's actually a pretty diverse academic center. And that's something I've come to value, right? When I talked about trying to find community and making sure that you have people that have kind of gone through these experiences so that you can kind of rely on them. And so, or like, you know, ask them questions, guide each other, and then help, you know, pull up the ones that are coming behind you. And so I am, you know, consciously now kind of seeking out places that are a bit more diverse further on my career.
Wow. You actually have written about the importance of having black cardiologists, black doctors in general, Black Lives Matter in the cath lab, to a proposal for the interventional cardiology community to counteract bias and racism. I'm skipping down. This is, you have a number of different suggestions for 5, enhance black community outreach and engagement for innovative as well as approved cath lab therapies. And you write, direct outreach to black community gathering places like barbershops have proven effective at improving blood pressure control in black men. Interventional cardiologists can engage the black community by attending health fairs and visiting black churches, fraternities, and sororities to educate lay audiences on the efficacy of invasive cardiac therapies. And I thought, wow, now the first part of this, this has already been shown to work out. You go to the barbershop and give out information on blood pressure control. This has already been shown to be effective?
Right, yep, that's been shown to be effective. There is primarily pharmacists at a barbershop, kind of with the education and the reassessments and things like that, they found that they were able to kind of decrease blood pressure over time effectively. And so we know that, you know, being in the community, having more access, right? Access to care, access to medical professionals, really helps, I think, motivate, when your doctor, when you can relate to them, when there's, I think, a bit more of a level of trust even sometimes, it can be very effective. I think throughout my training, I've always been one to try and get back into the community, kind of give back, because those are the things also I benefit from. There were people ahead of me that really helped out. I think it's very important for multiple reasons. One being that we're able to kind of give education that people may not be receiving about the importances of, healthy diet, education, taking your medications, different conditions. But then also, I think, kind of putting a face and making medicine a bit more relatable. In Birmingham, Alabama, while I was there, I remember going to church one Sunday, and I told one of the girls, asked me kind of what, she was probably like 6-7 years old at the time. She asked me what I did, and I told her I was a doctor. And she's like, no, you're not. I was like, yeah, I'm a doctor. She's like, no. She's like, are you sure you're not like a tech or a nurse or something? And again, there's nothing wrong with being a nurse or being like amazing, amazing careers and people, and they've helped save my life, but she could not conceive of a world where a black person like her was a doctor, because she wasn't seeing it. And so I think it's so important for us to be in the community, for people to see, like, hey, I can be, I grew up in the generation where before Obama, I thought, I just heard, never had a black president. And so it was something I never even thought to aspire to, because I thought like that just can't happen, you know? And so I know how that was, you know, radical for me. And I can't even imagine people that were older than me and, you know, kind of what they walked through to finally, you know, see Obama in the White House. But yeah, I think it's so important to be in the community to help with education, help with, you know, increasing, I think, access to healthcare. But then, yeah, making sure that people see that, hey, you can be a cardiologist, you can be an astronaut, you can be anything you put your mind to.
Modeling is super important. We've talked about that in so many different. That's why, in my view, Dr. Uzindu's med school class was what it wasn't even a bunch to begin with, 8 out of 100. And then that got whittled down to 2. And then both of them, academic probation. And then you see the pattern. He comes out and she's, I'm a doctor. No, you're not. Stop lying. You know you're a tech. Like, dang, what? Insincere again. Like, I'm in here, these old sassy black males trying to lie and say, you know you're not. You can't even spell doctor. I'm skipping down. This is the same report, Black Lives Matter in the Cath Lab 2. Number 6, implicit bias mitigation workshops for cath lab professionals. And you write, in a vignette-based study, physicians with implicit association tests results.
It's not racism.
And racism. People came into white women being hostile. Anywho, Dr. Uzindu, I'm saying,
implicit bias mitigation. Number 6, you write, in a vignette-based study, physicians with implicit association test results showing negative implicit biases towards black individuals were less likely to treat black as opposed to white heart attack patients with thrombolytic therapy despite identical clinical scenarios. In a more recent study investigating predictors of early versus late coronary angiography in patients presenting with acute coronary syndromes, black race surfaced as an independent risk factor for late angiography, defined as more than 72 hours after hospital admission.
Can't even get through the paragraph, my goodness. I thought this was so important because, one, I guess this is another one people can think about, unconscious and all the rest of it. But I mean, life and death impact of white supremacy racism?
Yeah. So, you know, there have now been multiple studies that show this, black patients presenting with a heart attack were, you know, and again, maybe it was a milder form of a heart attack. But those that are presenting with this maybe milder form of heart attack were taken to the cath lab for an intervention where they put a stent in or see if they need a stent, that they may wait a bit longer than, you know, non-black people. Or the likelihood of them thinking that that, you know, going to an ER, a black patient might be less likely to be treated. I mean, there's like a lot of studies, like even when I kind of talked about pain, less likely to be treated with pain medication or adequate pain medication compared to similar white patients. And so there are a lot, or it might be a bit more delayed. There are a lot of different ways that, you know, we've kind of realized that there are differences in how black patients are treated as they're going through the medical system. Of late, since kind of the events that occurred in 2020 and what happened to, you know, the execution truly of George Floyd, there's now been most medical schools require some of this education and training within their medical school curriculum, because it's not enough for someone to say, I don't believe I'm racist, or I don't think I'm racist, and you know, I treat all my patients equally. We're realizing that that's truly not the case, and I think people need to be aware of that. aware of maybe what their bias is or how bias, racism affects Black patients to truly start trying to understand ways to improve care. We've kind of summarized some, I wish that was all the data, but there's a lot of different, a lot of different studies over the last, few decades now that have shown, Black patients that had a cardiac, and this is an older study, but a study about 2 decades ago, Black patients that had a cardiac arrest, at that point, after a cardiac arrest, you're supposed to get a defibrillator, implanted. And they were less likely to receive that implanted defibrillator than non-Black patients or Black patients that could potentially either get a surgery to treat some slow or bad blood flow to their legs versus amputation. They were more likely to get an amputation than, kind of surgical treatment of their vascular disease or the blood flow disease in their legs. And so a lot of data showing that, we haven't treated Black patients going through the medical system fairly. And again, I think me as a patient, there are things I've kind of seen, experienced that have been interesting, to say the least. But hopefully shedding a light on it, kind of publications like ours and, truly a lot of people publishing and, going around medical schools and academic centers across the country teaching and making sure that we're putting steps in place and devising strategies to try and eradicate some of the disparities that we're seeing in care.
Want to point out for our listeners, during our 14 years of broadcasting, Dorothy Roberts was a guest with us way back in 2009. A listener asked her about amputations and potential, what they call racial disparities, racially disparate impact. And when she came back on the program 2 years later, 2011, we were talking about her book, Fatal Invention. She had got data to confirm exactly what we just heard from Dr. Uzindu, that Black people, surprisingly, are more likely to get an amputation probably after they've had poor treatment, no treatment, under treatment, racist treatment, all the way through. Everyone obviously would like to keep all of their appendages and everything and be as healthy as possible. But this was 2011. It's 2023 now. That's another big one where, dang, it seems like a lot of this information has been known and reported for a long time, and we can't get this problem solved. That sort of thing leads me to believe that racists are dedicated, entrenched with what they are doing, practicing racism. Specifically, I wanted to make sure that I asked, I guess, number one, you already told us you were born in Missouri. I had paused for Michael Brown Jr. But you did share that your parents were born in Nigeria. We've heard frequently where even a number of the Black people who are in med school, if they're classified as Black, they were not born in this part of the world. And some people have talked about how they think that's another component of white supremacy racism, where people that were born in this part of the world seem like it's going to be even more difficult. Do you see that sort of dynamic in terms of trying to even pit conflict between or not allowing Black people that were born here even to go through the med process? If we're going to have Black people, they're going to be non-white people that were born elsewhere outside the U.S.?
Yeah, that's a good question. I would say, if we look at statistics, I don't know the statistics off the top of my head. I haven't necessarily looked at it, but I would say anecdotally, just, kind of going through, medical school process, residency, all that sort of stuff. I would say, I'd say more likely than not. I'd say it's more 50-50, or maybe even a little bit more, where potentially the majority of Black people that I'm seeing are in kind of medical training, are at least a little bit closer to, their African roots, whether that's they came from Africa or their parents, like myself, came from Africa. compared to Black people that, you know, historically have been here, you know, for multiple generations. And so, yeah, I think there are a lot of different things, you know, that need to occur to really try and make sure that everyone's having opportunities to get into the medical field, to, you know, succeed in, you know, all different sectors and, you know, healthcare included. I would say, at least from experience and what I've seen, I would say probably it's probably a majority of Black students in medical schools or in medical training have closer roots to Africa, whether they're the generation that came or their parents' generation was the one that came from Africa.
Fascinating. Again, individuals classified as white in charge of all of that in terms of who's going to be allowed to go regardless. Make sure I didn't miss any questions. Make sure I didn't miss studying virtual one. All the same. Can't believe that I had that at the beginning. I guess I got confused. I thought I'd asked it before. You mentioned growing up in St. Louis and having heard things. I think you said North St. Louis. Spanish Lake, is that familiar? Spanish Lake?
Yeah, no, I've heard of Spanish Lake, but no, I was in South County. I was in southern suburb of St. Louis. Yeah.
Okay. I think that's northern part of St. Louis, Spanish Lake. So yeah, totally. Opposite geographically, but yes, Michael Brown Jr. Did you hear about the reports before? Let you enjoy the rest of your Tuesday evening. Did you hear about the reports of a possible serial killer in the Kansas City, Missouri area where they had different Black females missing?
That sounds familiar. Was this a few months ago?
Yes, sir. Towards the end of 2022? Yes, sir.
Yeah. I didn't really follow that news story, but I remember seeing that. I do remember seeing that.
We talked about that a couple of months back. Bishop Caldwell was a guest on the program, Black Male. He had been, they said he was lying and making things up at first, and then they had a Black female who escaped from the dungeon. I don't even know what you want to call lair, clutches. He had built like a prison makeshift in his basement. This white man, she had like a dog collar on. Like it was, I was going to say crazy, but I don't even know what you want to call that. Anyway, all of that was right, same area. We've been speaking with Dr. Uzindu. Man, it has been a pleasure, even slight disruption, but man, you and Dr. Paul S. Chan, who was with us the first part of the program, and then we kind of switched it up midway with Dr. Anezi Uzindu. But wow, I've learned so much, if anything, like a huge public service announcement. I even looked while we were chatting with you two this evening to see, and they do, depending obviously on where you are, they do have free CPR classes. If you look online, I would look, because they can be pricey sometimes, but I would look. Sometimes they might have virtual classes, but just see if you can find the resources and share. I think Irie, she heard us talking about this a few months back. She got a CPR class for her area. Huge gold star for her to get more Black people so that they're informed with life, literally life-saving information. Dr. Chan, before he left, he said, hey, it's people that you're around. It could be someone in your house, a relative, a friend at the basketball court. And hey, just because I took that little bit of time, I can help keep this person alive and make sure that they don't have brain damage. Dr. Chan talked with us about that too. Like, man, so important. I am super inspired. 3.9 honors med student. Dr. Uzindu has been hanging out with us this evening. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Tuesday evening from denied, I can't even say dishwasher. He was rejected as a dishwasher to cardiologist. That is coming from the bottom for real. Thank you so much for your time and brilliant insight, sir.
Oh, thank you so much, Gus, for having me. Thank obviously for having Paul Chan, Dr. Chan as well. Really, really appreciate the opportunity to shed light on this. And, thank you to the listeners and viewers for, the insightful questions. And it's great to have these dialogues. And hopefully, we continue to be the change kind of rattle some of the systems that are in place and educate people on CPR and what a cardiac arrest is and all those sorts of things so that we can help save lives. So thanks so much for creating this platform for us to have this conversation.
Thank you. Keep up the outstanding work and keep publishing, keep teaching it. CPR, encouraging CPR, more black people, non-white people, victims of racism. Learn CPR and then share, promote it with others. Thank you so much for your outstanding work, Dr. Uzindu. Keep up the brilliant scholarship, and we will look forward to more of your products in the future.
Thank you. You guys have a good night.
Thank you, sir. You too. Context of white supremacy. Wow. One, I'm so glad we could have this program. That Damar Hamlin. We would not have done this program if that incident had not happened with Damar Hamlin, where he almost died. I guess scientifically he did, because his heart stopped beating and he wasn't breathing. They had to resuscitate him twice, according to reports, unless I've been misinformed. Basically. But lucky. We started last year talking about lucky in a totally different context, but I mean, that is true. Lucky Damar Hamlin, brain damage and all, if that incident hadn't happened, because we talked about this report back in October, thought it was important. We had, I mentioned it today. I said, we had the young lady, she dialed in and talking about learning CPR only after she moved to a white high school. We had Irie, she talked about the, and we had a number of folks who talked about, CPR and the impact, how they learned it, when they learned it, if they learned it at all, and, all the rest of it. And that is huge. He said, even the part where he said, hey, black people are less likely to get CPR in any environment, even a so-called black neighborhood. That lets me know a lot about the system of white supremacy racism. So very glad we could have this program, which we would not have done. I was not even thinking when I heard that report. I really was not, we should try and see if we can get the authors of that report as guests on the program. I was not thinking that at all. Dr. Uzindu is not even one of the co-authors of that report. He's one of Dr. Chan's colleagues, and he just, invited him because they do the same work. Said they see each other every day. But I'm glad we did. If nothing else, to motivate people, learn CPR. Super important. He said he watched. I didn't even know Zeke Upshaw died on the court. How many black males go out and die on the court or on the field for these ball games? Like live on television. He said that's on YouTube. Be it a basketball gym full of people and not one person knows CPR. What a disgrace. And they cheer about DeMar. You can go back and timestamp me. Literally, he was still on the field. Like I said, I was confused at first. I didn't even know he was dead. Technically, they had to resuscitate him. I didn't even know. Much less they had to do that twice. I tweeted live time. Hey, he had been a black male just hanging out in front of the liquor store, trying to go to the Whole Foods, go to the Costco, walk in the bank, go to the post office. Hey, my man out in Arizona, hang out in front of the bank, do an interview for the Wall Street Journal, and and go into cardiac arrest. They might have called the police on him not to assist him, but to, we've got a trespassing criminal nigra. He's doing the old fake heart attack. Yeah, we've seen that one before. The old nigra doing the fake cardiac arrest so he can rob and loot us. Anyway, in every environment, even black neighborhoods, less likely to get CPR. Very depressing. Anywho, 14 years terrorized the whole time. I was at a study room thinking, it'll be great. It'll be silent. Fast internet. Been chilling. I was working at the library anyway, all by myself. What gives to come and be terrorized by some random white woman while we're in the middle of the program? We had to stop and... White women do it better. I am going to speak with the library staff immediately once all of this is over. Like when we're in that, already did the whole program. Like, man, that's been my entire existence on the planet. Terrorism, flagrant terrorism at the library from white people, staff, patrons, all of the above. No surprise there. You're not supposed to know CPR. Anything that is constructive. You see that? High fructose corn syrup. They got that by the bushel for the Negroes. Cheetos, KFC, stuff that'll kill you. Football. They got that by the bushel. CPR classes. Being unmolested in environments of learning. That. Ooh. Hard to come by. And my teaspoon of black male privilege, Dr. Uzindu, he said he will have that on his record for the rest of his life, sounding like a criminal when they go to look. Academic probation. I don't know if we want that boy. And it happened with both of the black males. They had weeded out everybody else, dwindled it down from 8 to 2. And then we get those last two on academic probation. Not by accident, boys and gals. Let us see. We should be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Let's see, folks who are with us, if you have commentary to share, let's see, retired firefighter, our caller at 2262 and 0356. Did you have commentary, what you heard from Dr. Paul S. Chan and Dr. Anezi Uzindu? I will say, well, one other note really quick. White guests only, for many reasons. Damar Hamlin is the only reason that we had this here program, CPR. That was so important since everyone is talking about that. The very limited times when we do have non-white guests, I think I will make it a habit to switch that question around and ask them, the non-white person victim of racism, if they have a definition of racism and to share their definition with us, because I think that makes the point in a much more effective manner. And none of this, I do not have a 3.9 anything. I don't even have $3.90 in my pocket. All I'm saying is I think it makes the point that we non-white people, we are not experts on racism, which he said, I'm an expert at cardiology. I'm not an expert on racism. I'm not a race scholar. I don't have a definition of racism, which, no problem. I didn't either until I started studying this specifically. And I'm submitting that the vast majority of non-white people, we, like Dr. Uzindu, we don't study racism. We're not experts at racism. We experience it. He said that. And he's right. We experience white supremacy racism as victims, me being terrorized in the study room. He sassed that white woman, you're insincere. We got boatloads of experience, but that does not in any way, shape, form mean that we understand racism, white supremacy, what it is, how it works. Enormous difference. Enormous. I've said that all the time. So many of us, we experience riding in a vehicle, and I mean in all kinds of ways, riding in the back seat, riding in the front seat, riding with our feet hanging out the window, riding dirty, as they say. We experience riding in a vehicle in all kinds of ways. I've said it for years. Many of us, we can't fill the windshield wiper fluid. Struggle filling the gas tank. And I don't mean economically have all the money in the world. Just getting the nozzle into the tank. Struggle. Struggle to get the headlights on. Where's the brighter button? How do you turn on the high beams? We're not even talking about popping the hood, folks. I'm just talking the basics. Experiencing does not make you an expert on anything. Those are two totally, totally different things. Anywho, we'll be here tomorrow, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Let's see. Retired firefighter in Florida, 22620356. Did y'all have commentary to share?
Yes, sir. The nature of my question was because, you know, before, you know, retirement, for a long time, we would talk about the idea that of a significant number of our emergency medical calls are things that people can, I mean, it's not even, you don't even have to be a high school graduate with most of these calls that we would be going on, you know, such as, you know, I have a headache, a cut, you know, things of that nature. These are things that, like I said before, if a 12-year-old, 13-year-old or higher, can basically do on their own, or, you know, assist somebody, you know, in that standpoint. And, you know, AEDs have been made so simple. It does the work for you. The machine itself would tell you to shock the person, as far as that concerned. I haven't seen them lately. They may have even improved on it since I've actually, you know, saw one of them, you know, took them out of the case. Yeah, of course, I'm not going to be doing that. I think it's from the standpoint of the fire departments basically, you know, making a lot of money, and most of the money comes from the rescue part of fire rescue. There is not going to be a significant number of people who's willing to go inside of fires, that's for sure. But I'm talking about the medical part. A lot of those calls can be taken care of by the people in that house or in that gym or in that church, you know, basically themselves. And most of them are not emergencies. A lot of those calls are not even emergencies as far as they're concerned. Somebody has a headache or vomiting, that's not an emergency, you know. That was the nature of my question. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Did anybody else have commentary to share? Grant, folks satisfied? deaf CPR classes in your area, you should check, see, like I said, YMCA, churches, lots of schools, lots of public places where they can accommodate a large number or group of people to fit into an area. Do this. Check them out. You can even just look. When do they have free, or call some of the places where they offer and ask, do they have free classes? Do they have scholarships, maybe vouchers? They might have different wording for it, but ask and see, because it can be pricey sometimes. Ask if they have large events, if they do something for like school. I mean, they should never, anything where it's some sort of athletic event, anything, I would think, track and field, basketball, swimming, anything, I would think if it's not at least one medical person there, at least the coach, somebody is, okay, PD has had CPR, you know, maybe PD doesn't know the full playbook and never played, is not the best athlete, but PD does know CPR, so he's, you know, he's on the staff. You make sure PD travels with the team. Like, dang, that is disgraceful. Zeke Upshaw, that is disgraceful. Learn CPR. And it's not even for the, I mean, the athletics, that's important. Damar Hamlin, for sure, that's important. But Dr. Chan, he said, hey, just regular people every day hanging out, that's where it's most likely to be used. Somebody that's just around you in the house, library, wherever else they happen to be at work. That was mentioned in the report specifically, in the workplace. And you're just there. Uh-oh, they're having a problem. Let me get to doing my compressions. Staying Alive, I think that's the song that they've been given for a long time. Staying Alive. I don't know why they haven't updated the song, but I guess people still play that one. That one's still well-known enough that they can use it for the number of beats per minute. But hey, save lives, and man, make sure that you share it with other black men. I would even include that, hey, even in places with black people don't get CPR. Make sure we learn it. If you see somebody that looks like they need help, ask if they need help. We are conditioned not to help this would be another one. We are conditioned to help white people. White people are in every environment, even in the environments where it's poor black people, where you got people who most likely have not received this training, even in those environments, white people are way more likely to get CPR assistance from bystanders. So teach the training, learn it yourself, stay current with your, I think you have to get it renewed every couple of years or so, just so you can stay aware. They make changes and things. Like you said, they don't do the mouth-to-mouth anymore. So stay current with the information and what have you. I mean, man, save black life. He said he had a heart attack at 25. At 25. That's what this system is designed to do. Nah. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. White guest. Sobriety would be best. Overall health, man, that's one way right there. We do not need any fire, water, and narcotics. As long as we are trying to replace white supremacy with justice, let's put a premium on health. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask you to help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.